Hey guys, so when I recorded and uploaded the video in which I talked about the fact that I started graduate school, a couple of people that responded to that video were like, "What? Why did you do that? Like, that doesn't make sense. You're being stupid. You know, you have this much debt already. Why did you go to graduate school?" I thought that video kind of explains that, but apparently it didn't too. Those few people, and I feel like a lot of people who would watch it would maybe have the same kind of reaction. So in this video, this is my defense of why I'm in graduate school and what it means for me being a graduate student with this much student debt already and increasing my debt by being a graduate student, because it is an increase. It is a different kind of increase, but nonetheless, it is an increase. So just as a background, before I started graduate school, I graduated from New York University with a bachelor's in 2010. That graduation meant that I had a student debt of about over $105,000. That was my loan situation. I had a debt that big. And you're given 6 months grace period before you have to start making the minimum monthly payments to start paying the loans back, right? Paying the debt back. Grace period ended before I found a job, right? I think. Or no, by the time grace period ended, I actually had a job. Never mind, no, that's not true. But I had a job that wasn't enough to make a living and to afford my living and also make my loan payments. I did pay back, make payments, but it wasn't enough, for the minimum monthly payment, which is a huge amount. When you have a debt as large as $105,000, that means your minimum monthly payment, and my interest rate was actually pretty low. Two of my loans have an interest rate about 2%, I think. It is 2%. Very low. It's my third loan that I received at my fourth year of undergraduate student that has a really big interest rate. It's also the largest loan in terms of the amount that it is. Now, my loan is $105,000. My student debt after graduating college was $105,000, but it could have been much larger. My first year was paid for, so I didn't take any loans for my freshman year in college. Keep that in mind. I also did receive a good amount of scholarships. I wouldn't say it's like a huge, significant amount, but every year of my college education, I received $7,500 in scholarships. So add that up, 7,500 times 4, that is the amount of scholarships I got. I also did not have, I was not in the school dormitory. I was for the first year, but after that I wasn't. So I didn't have to take a loan for that amount. So that would have been larger. Anyway, the point is, I had a debt about $105,000 after I graduated college. But it could have been much larger. It could have been close to about $160,000. Anyway, with the debt about $105,000 and with the interest rate of about, combined average interest rate about 6%, my monthly payment, minimum monthly payment that I had to make was about $860 a month, which is bigger than my rent at the time. My rent at the time was about $650. Actually, because I was living with roommates, I was actually much cheaper than that. It was like five something. Anyway, much larger than my rent payment. I had a job, but it was like a seasonal job kind of thing. By the time summer hit, I was not, it was no longer going to be able to help me make a living. I almost had to like give up being in New York City. But ultimately, I did find a job working at a homeless shelter. It is a pretty low salary job considering. The job on paper requires a high school degree, and that's pretty much it. But almost all my coworkers at least had a college degree, or was going for master's or had a master's. So yeah, that job was like the salary, because I did so much overtime. Ultimate salary was like, I don't know, $34,000 a year, $35,000 a year. I'm not sure the exact amount I received from that job, but through that job, I actually was able to make a living and also make my monthly payment. It wasn't easy. I'm telling you, I was really frugal. But ultimately, by the time I applied for graduate school, my student debt became about something like $70,000, right? From 105 to 70,000 in 3 years. So I did pay back. Of course, some amount of money that I paid back was the help I received from my mom. Okay, my mom is a nurse. So she's the breadwinner. She's always been the breadwinner in my family. She's always made the most money, the highest income in my family. My dad's a pastor. His income is not, as a pastor, what do you expect a salary of a pastor to be? Not that great. Actually, when he started as a pastor in Tennessee, he wasn't making any income. He was kind of doing pro bono. So no income being a pastor, because the church was in bankruptcy and had minus money. And so in order to help church grow, he was like, okay, fine. For 6 months, I will not be receiving any income whatsoever to help the church. That's the kind of person my dad is anyway. But yeah, so I applied for graduate school. Now, why did I go? Why did I decide to increase my debt again, even though I paid back a good amount of it? And it was not an easy decision, honestly, but I felt like it's the decision I had to make. This was the right decision for me. And this is the kind of video in which I explain why that's the case. So why did I go to graduate school, despite the fact that there are so many negatives to starting this graduate school? Well, the biggest reason is I want to be a social worker. That's really like the simplest explanation for this. I want to be a social worker. Now, many of you guys might not know what that means, what that entails, but know this, that in most states in America, most all states, if you don't have a master's degree in social work, you don't get to be a social worker, okay? You need a master's to be a social worker. I want to be a social worker. So that's right off the bat, the biggest and probably like the simplest reason for this is that my passion is to be a social worker. Kind of like if you want to be a teacher, let's say. If you want to be a teacher in most states, well, maybe not most states, but in some states like New York, you need a master's degree in education to be a teacher. Kind of like that. And you know, you're going to accrue more debt. Teaching profession is not known for a high salary. But if you want to be a teacher, and if that's your passion, you got to get your master's. All right? So that's the major reason behind that. It was not an easy decision to go to start graduate school, simply because of this. About a couple of months before I started graduate school, I had an interview with this awesome organization. It's a nonprofit organization that provides services to people living with HIV and AIDS and who are also in need of assistance in housing. So they're homeless population that live with HIV and AIDS, right? I had a job offer and I would have gotten it. I would have gotten that job because the interview was awesome. I was really qualified for this job. I would have gotten this job, and it was a job that has a salary about $38,000 a year. Not a high salary range, but definitely a job that would build my experience as a person working in the nonprofit world. It was being a care manager. So it's not just like, you know, bottom of the totem pole kind of a job with nowhere to go. You know, it's a care manager job. If I work at it for 3 years, 4 years, it builds on my resume and I could move up from there. This is the job I gave up to go to graduate school, okay? So this was not an easy decision. But I felt it's the right decision for me because I want to be a social worker. And that means doing this graduate school. Now, also kind of differentiating factor for me in this is that, well, I had an experience being able to pay back my debt monthly, making that monthly payment with the job that pays $34,000 a year, with the job that barely pays $35,000 a year. It was hard, but I was able to manage it with even that low a salary, right? And I consider it low salary, but consider this. Minimum wage is $7.50. It varies depending on the states, but that's like the general minimum wage in America. $7.50. I was making about $35,000 a year. So if you count that on an hourly basis, that's about $15 an hour. A little bit more, actually. So I was making twice the amount of minimum wage, but that, in terms of salary, means about $35,000 a year, which is still considered a horrible salary. So just goes to show you the salary you could make from a minimum wage is horrible, just ridiculously horrible. But I'm not going to go into that discussion. But even with a ridiculously bad salary, I was making the monthly payments. So, you know, I figured I could do it. I've done it for 2 years. And my parents, my mom only had to come in to help me because I was unemployed. But if I have a job, paying back my debt is not an issue. If I have a job, with the bachelor's, I could definitely get a job that's, you know, pays $15 an hour. With the master's as a social worker, that's pretty much a given. I'll make at least that if I get a job. In my field, social work is a field known for, well, unemployment rate for my field is extremely low. The demand for social workers is always pretty much high. It's not a job where I'm going to graduate and be like, oh my gosh, I can't find work. That's not a problem. The problem that most people will have is that the work of a social worker is demanding, is hard, is challenging, is taxing, and is emotionally grueling. And at the same time, the pay is not that high. That's the problem. But the problem never really is, I can't find a job. You'll probably find a job, just that job probably won't even pay that much. For the most part, I mean, there are social work fields where you'll get a job right off the bat and the salary will be pretty great. Unfortunately, the type of social work that I want to get into is not that kind of job. But anyway, it really has to do about passion, following what I want to do. If I was just following the money, if I was, you know, going to graduate school to do something that would make me tons of money, of course, it doesn't make sense to go into social work at all, you know. But the fact of the matter, the simple reason is I want to be a social worker. And to be a social worker, I need at least a master's degree. At least, you know. So my plan really is to get that master's. And get it licensed. I'm going to take the exam and turn it into a licensed master's social work degree. Because why not? It's only a test, right? And then under supervision, being accredited to change it into like something like LCSW, Licensed Clinical Social Work Major. In which case, my opportunities are much more. But I think paying back the debt is doable. And in this case, increasing my debt doesn't bother me as much because the loans I've taken out for graduate school are government loans. For my undergraduate education, it's been private loans. That's why it's been so difficult. Private loans are really, really difficult. There's not many options you can do. The Citibank and Discover Bank both, they're both like, hey, here's the amount you owe us. You have to pay us back in 10 years. Okay? Here's your interest rate. Again, you have to pay us back in 10 years. This is your monthly minimum required payment. Right? No alternative. No option, no negotiation. That's it. That's final. Right? If I don't make that minimum monthly payment amount for consecutively, if I miss payments for 3 months or 4 months, I think it's 3 months actually. No, for 4 months. If I miss it, I default. That's it. If I default, that means that, you know, I can't really pay them back the amount of money I have, but I'm pretty much screwed at that point. So I have 4 month leeway, and even if I'm making late payments, that just fucks me up greatly. So private loans is inflexible. There's no alternative. There's no options. There's no negotiations. There's no this, you know, what is it? What was one of the things that they, that's mentioned, like defaulting for, There's a word that starts with F that I can't really seem to recall right now. With the letter F. It's when you... It's possible with government loans, but it's not possible with private loans. Right? Forestalling? No. Something with F. Like, if you don't have enough money to make the payments, you can negotiate with the government, be like, give me some more time. Or suspend my debt for a while, increase my interest as you're doing so, but just give me time because right now I can't do it. It's not possible for me. Government allows that. Private bank says, nope, can't do that. You gotta pay. or else. That's one of the things, you know. With government loans, it's there. Also, government loans means I'm eligible for many different things. For example, if I make at least a certain percentage of my loans every month for 10 years, then I get loan forgiven. I get my loans forgiven. I no longer have to pay any of my loans, especially if I'm working in a nonprofit agency or a government agency. If that's the case, and it will most likely definitely be the case with me because I'm a social worker, all the fields that I'm going to be working in are going to be nonprofit. So because of that, it makes handling the loans much easier. It's going to increase my debt from, what is it now? It's like 68 to probably, by the time I graduate, it's going to go to about 100-something. Again, right? I've done it. I've had 100K before, and I brought it back down. But by the time I graduate, it's going to be up to about 100K again. But I think I can manage it because, you know, I'll graduate and I'll be a social worker. One thing you have to realize about the social work field is that as you are a student, internship is mandatory. 21 hours a week at least, or just 21 hours a week of internship is mandatory to graduate with the social work degree, and that's for 2 years. So because of that, what that means is that I get connected to people who offer me jobs after I graduate. And also, because master's in social work is that big deal for this field, the school will help me connect me to a job, you know, in the social work field. So getting a job is going to be much easier with the master's degree in social work. Again, like I said, once I have a job, I have no problem. I don't think I'll have an issue of being able to pay back my student debt. And I'm currently doing it, even with the horrible wage I'm making currently, you know, as a graduate student. But that's really the ultimate reason. It's a simple reason, you know, this is what I want to do with my life. You know, I know STEM majors make more money, ultimately, you know. I know if I went into the medical field or if I took vocational training. I know that if I became an electrician or an engineer, or any of those things, I would probably make more money in the long run. Yes. But that's not what I'm interested in. You know? It's not what I want to do with my life. It's not what brings me fulfillment. It's not what brings me reward in doing my work. That's what it is, you know? We make life decisions based on what we're good at and what we want to achieve. You know, that's kind of like the you know, in some ways, I think people define their purpose in life by achieving that what they want to do with their life. Some people make tons of money in a job, you know, but they hate their jobs. I don't want to be one of those people. Is it a foolish thing to want to work, you know, to have that kind of dream? Am I being way too idealistic? Perhaps. Maybe I am. Maybe I am being stupid and foolish to thinking that, you know, this is what I want to do with my life, so I'm going to pursue it. Even though it's going to mean that I end up with this student loan debt that is pretty ridiculous. Perhaps you guys are right on that. But in my defense, that's what I want to be. I don't really understand why someone pursuing social work gets this much flack compared to someone who wants to be a teacher, because it's the same thing. If someone wants to be a teacher, that person is not going to be making tons of money. And if that person is pursuing a teaching degree in New York City, well, that person's student debt is going to be pretty damn huge. But I don't think if that person decided to make a video talking like, so I went into graduate school for a teaching degree, would that person receive the same degree of criticism for doing that? I'm not really sure. It seems like, you know, to me, it seems like this is the case because not many other people understand what social workers do and what being a social worker is, what that means, you know, and what that profession overall is like, you know, what kind of salary it is, what kind of unemployment rate it is, and all those kind of things. And also, my personal situation allows me to pursue this graduate student degree. I am very privileged. I I say that without shame, and because it's true. I'm a very privileged person. I'm an only child. I don't have any dependents. You know, I don't have children of my own. I have a very cheap living arrangement, and I have most importantly, I have my family income level. My family's socioeconomic status is not, you know, it's not a working class, or we're above, way above poverty level. You know, my mom at one point as a nurse was making like $110,000 a year. I am not a, you know, so I recognize my privilege. You know, I'm also of, you know, an Asian American who can speak English really well. So there's a certain amount of privileges that I have that I'm aware of that enables me to do this. And, you know, it sucks for those people really who don't have these kind of privileges and who must go through their challenges in life with not even just privileges, but with discrimination and with oppression faced at them. If I was, even if just one thing that changed about me was that I'm a girl, this would be more difficult, the thing that I'm doing. If one thing that changed about me was that I am, I have darker skin and I'm Mexican, or that I'm a black person, a lot of the privileges that I have currently would just be gone, and in place would be discrimination, and challenges that come with having that difference. So that's also something that I'm always mindful of, and something I hope that, you know, other people are always mindful of about each other. But ultimately, the bottom line, the main point is, you know, this is what I want to do, and I'm following my passion, really, and I think I can do it. And maybe it seems crazy, maybe you'll do your own math, and it doesn't seem to add up. Why would you do this when the math doesn't add up? You know, and I think people act beyond just mathematical reasons. If people only acted out of, you know, this is classical, this is like Austrian economics, right? People act reasonably, logically, and people, the thing that moves people the most, that motivates people the most, is money, is profit. So there's no other thing that drives people more than that. That's pretty much like the thing that makes microeconomics theories work, that assumption. My opinion, that assumption isn't always true. There are people who do things regardless of money motive, you know, because it's what they want to do. It's what their passion is. And somewhere along the way, some of those people who follow their passions, they'll end up making a lot of money. Some might not. Some might end up just dirt poor, or some might end up not making it and become homeless, or, you know, or all kinds of different situations. I'm not saying I'm confident, I'm absolutely positive and certain that I'll make it to becoming what I want to be. I realize there are going to be many challenges. It's going to be pretty difficult with the debt situation that I have. And I'm not even certain that I'll even be able to graduate school, because there's going to be a lot of challenges that come. I don't know what's going to happen in my life. I don't know what's going to happen in my future. I just have a plan for myself. And this is what I'm going to do to kind of make that plan happen for me. But am I certain about it? No. Nothing in life is certain. But I'm trying. And this is my trying. And this is why, ultimately, in a long-winded way, that is why I'm in graduate school, to be a social worker. Now, what kind of social worker do I want to be? I'm not actually sure yet. I'm still coming to develop ideas about that. I know what social worker I don't want to be. So I'm starting to develop ideas on that. You know, for example, I don't want to be a social worker in a hospital. I don't want to be a hospital social worker or a medical social worker. I don't want to be a social worker in foster care systems, or foster homes or foster care agencies. So I'm starting to develop ideas on that. I'm actually warming up to the idea of becoming like a clinical social worker, which I never really had an interest in that, but it seems much more like a thing. And clinical social worker, actually, money is big in there, in that area. I would make pretty good salary if I went into that field. So, again, I'm learning as I go, But one thing that hasn't changed is that this is the field that I want to pursue.